Maxillary Canine. Did you know that in constructing any four-walled building, four cornerstones exist at the base where two walls meet? These are no ordinary stones. They are large, strong, and bear the weight of the entire building. They are strategically placed at the most prominent location on the outside of the building. Similarly, Armouts also has four cornerstones, the canines. They can be categorized as two maxillary and two mandibular canines that are situated at the corners of the mouth. They are the longest teeth in the dental arch, nearly 25 to 27 millimeter from crown to root tip. The tooth develops from four lobes, with a highly developed middle lobe giving rise to a single prominent cusp. Due to their unique crown shape, they possess a self-cleansing property. This quality, combined with the labiolingual thickness of the crown and root, along with secure anchorage in the alveolar process of the jaws, make them the most stable in the mouth. To gain a better understanding of them, we will take a closer look at their anatomy. In this video, we will discuss the maxillary canine. Let's begin with its chronology. The first evidence of calcification occurs at 4 to 5 months. Enamel formation is at 6 to 7 years. Eruption takes place at 11 to 12 years. And root formation is completed at 13 to 15 years. Now let's examine the tooth from various aspects to describe its crown morphology. The most prominent component visualized from this aspect is the cusp. The canines have a sharp pointed cusp. Let's discuss the outlines first. The cervical outline is curved with the convexity facing the root. From its mesialmost end, the mesial outline follows a straight path or may show a slight concavity till the junction of the middle and incisal thirds, which represents the mesial crest of curvature. From here, the outline transitions into the cusp slope. How do we define a cusp? Unlike the incisors, canines have a cusp instead of an incisal edge or ridge. It has two slopes, a mesial slope and a distal slope. Originating from the mesial crest of curvature, the outline descends along a slope towards the cusp tip, known as the mesial cusp slope. From the cusp tip, the outline of the distal cusp slope commences and ends at the distal crest of curvature situated in the middle of the middle third. The cusp tip is centered over the root, with the mesial slope shorter than the distal slope. The distal outline commences from here, and it exhibits concavity until reaching the distalmost end of the cervical line. Next, let's also observe the labial surface. Walking on it would be like walking uphill and then downhill. This is due to its notable protrusion in the center, known as the labial ridge. Comprising three lobes, the labial surface features a prominently developed middle lobe, resulting in the formation of the labial ridge. Now let's draw a line over the crest of this ridge, from the cervical line to the tip of the cusp. We can observe that it is curved and inclined mesially at its center. Note that the surface mesial to the labial ridge shows convexity, while the surface distal to the ridge shows concavity, that is more marked towards the cervical third of the crown.
Pop quiz.
Now let's turn the tooth to view the lingual aspect. The crown is narrower lingually than labially. The outlines are mirror images of the labial outline, except for the cervical line, as it shows less curvature. Now let's observe the lingual surface. We imagined the lingual fossa of the incisor as a lake, bounded by ridges. The canine is a little different, as it has a walkway in the middle of the lake, making the lingual surface have two prominent fossae. The cervical boundary of the fossae is bounded by a very well-developed cingulum. On either side, prominent mesial and distal marginal ridges converge at the cusp tip. In addition to this, there is a walkway connecting the cusp tip and the cingulum, called the lingual ridge. This well-developed ridge divides the lingual fossa into two shallow fossae, that is, the mesial and distal lingual fossae, or into two small lakes. However, this isn't always the case. Variations exist, and there are instances when the lingual surface seems smooth, making it challenging to distinguish between the fossa and ridges as they are confluent. Next, let's examine the tooth from the mesial aspect. Notably, it appears wider when viewed from this aspect compared to labial or lingual aspects, owing to its greater labiolingual dimensions than mesiodistal dimensions. Let's trace the outlines. It is similar to that of the incisors, having a wedge shape with the base at the cervical third and the apex at the cusp tip. Focus on the cervical line. It is curved toward the crown, approximately by 2.5 mm. Starting from the labial end of the cervical line, the labial outline follows a convex path with the maximum convexity present at the junction of the middle and cervical third, representing the labial crest of curvature. It then transitions into a short cuspal outline. Continuing from the labial outline, the lingual outline first exhibits a slight convexity at the incisal third, followed by a concavity, representing the lingual fossa. It further proceeds with more convexity, indicating the cingulum with the crest of curvature positioned at the cervical third. If you were to run your hand along the mesial surface, you'll notice convexities throughout, except for a small circumscribed area just above the contact area, found at the junction of the middle and incisal third. The surface is concave and flat in this region, extending from that area to the cervical line. Let's now examine the tooth from the distal aspect. The outlines are the mirror images as that of the mesial aspect. The few differences that can be noted are lesser curvature of the cervical line, the distal marginal ridge is heavier and irregular. The distal surface exhibits more concavity above the contact area.
Pop quiz.
Lastly, let's also view the tooth from incisal aspect. The greater labiolingual dimensions than the mesiodistal dimensions can be confirmed from this aspect. Labially, the highly developed middle lobe is evident through its convexity at the cervical third, representing the labial ridge that becomes broader and flatter at the middle and incisal thirds. The distal concavity of the labial surface is also very noticeable from this aspect. On the lingual side, the prominent cingulum makes up the cervical third, presenting a convex outline. Now imagine a line drawn through the center of the crown labiolingually. Focus on the tip of the cusp. What is the relationship between the cusp tip and this line? It's not on the same line, but slightly mesial to it. Also, imagine another line drawn mesiodistally through the center. The tip of the cusp is labial to it. Thus, the tip of the cusp of a maxillary canine is labial to the center of the crown labiolingually and mesial to the center mesiodistally. Having learned about the crown morphology, let's now look at the root morphology. The maxillary canine typically possesses the longest root among teeth, with an average length of 17 mm, though there may be an exception in the case of the mandibular canine. Similar to the crown, the root is wider labiolingually than mesiodistally and exhibits a conical shape with a bluntly pointed apex, occasionally featuring a sharp curve, usually directed distally. The labial surface is smooth and convex. In contrast, The lingual portion is narrower than the labial aspect, providing a clear view of most mesial and distal surfaces. The mesial surface appears broader and displays shallow developmental depressions, while the distal surface exhibits more pronounced depressions. These developmental depressions contribute to root stability in the alveoli, preventing rotation and displacement. Next, let's briefly delve into its pulpal morphology. As you may already know, the pulp of a tooth consists of the pulp chamber and root canal. The pulp chamber is triangular, with the apex pointed towards the incisal edge when viewed labiopalatally. When viewed mesiodistally, it appears narrow and flame-like. There is a pulp horn corresponding to the single cusp. The root canal is wider in the labiolingual dimension than in the mesiodistal dimension. The cross-sectional shape of the canal is ovoid in the cervical and middle third of the root, while it can take up a circular shape in the apical third. And that's a wrap. In the next video, we will discuss the mandibular canine. Hope you had fun learning with us.